Like with all touchscreens on the FEELWORLD series, the monitor is split in half, kind of invisibly, where the left half of the monitor is going to be for... All right, people, let's get into it. I am Garrett. Today, we are looking at this on-camera monitor. This is kind of the best of all worlds of the monitors that we have looked at lately in terms of on-camera monitors. This is the FEELWORLD LUT6S. This is in a family of four monitors. There is the LUT6, LUT6S, LUT7, and LUT7S. The difference between the LUT and the LUT-S are the SDI versus HDMI only. The LUT6 and the LUT7 are HDMI only, where the LUT-S's, 6 and 7, are both HDMI and SDI. So depending on the camera that you are rocking will determine kind of which monitor you think that you will need. The nice thing about this is that, as the name implies, the size of these monitors are 6 inches and 7 inches. As you can probably see on the badge here is that this is an ultra bright monitor. We've talked about this a lot. It stands true. If you have a monitor that is probably less than 1,000 nit, it's going to be very difficult to see out in broad daylight. Sunshine is the enemy of monitors. Now, daylight viewable monitors, monitors that have that above 1,000 nit count, are bright enough that you can usually combat that. This monitor, the LUT6 and LUT6S, has a 2600 nit monitor, so it is plenty bright for your outdoor shoots, which right out the rip makes this a very compelling monitor. Now, it says that it is a 4K monitor. That means that it accepts a 4K signal. It is a 1920 by 1080 16:9 display, but it will accept a 4K HDMI signal. It accepts a 2K SDI signal, but most of your SDI cameras will auto convert down when it sends a signal out. So it is a full 1080p display. Going over this monitor here, this also, by the way, is a touch screen. So this functions very similarly to the other touch screens that we've seen from FEELWORLD. But across the top, we have the rocker here that also presses. This is one way that you can access all of your menus. You have your power button here, which seconds as a touch lock button. So if you press and hold, you can power it on or power it off. And if you just simple press, you can then lock the touch screen. So if you like the settings that you have, you don't want to accidentally bump it, you can push that and it would go away. On the sides here, you have the HDMI and SDI, because of course this is the S model. The thing that's great about this that FEELWORLD does with most of their monitors, if not all of their monitors, is that they're all loop through monitors, meaning that the signal that comes into the camera is the same signal that is going to come out of the camera. This is really handy if you have other accessories like an EVF or a wireless video transmission system. You're able to still use that stuff on this rigging with this monitor, which is fantastic. On the bottom, we have a couple of things here. Headphone jack, so then that way you can monitor your audio levels. You have a 12-volt DC in. This is just your standard barrel plug here, so if you want to run DC power off of universal batteries, like V-mount, goal-mount, that kind of thing, you can do that there. Quarter 20 thread on the bottom for mounting on accessories. It has an 8.4 volt DC out, which is pretty cool. So then you could also in turn take the DC power in and then push that power right back out to another accessory. So you don't have to bulk things down with a whole bunch of batteries. We then also have the SD card reader here. This, like many of the other FEELWORLD monitors, you can load LUTs directly into the monitor. So you can have preview LUTs built in, which is really, really neat. On the other side, we have the other quarter 20 mounting point. And then on the back here, because this is an ultra bright monitor, meaning that it is going to be pushing out a whole bunch of brightness, it gets hot, so it is an active fan cooled monitor. Again, the fan's not loud, you're not really going to notice it, it's not going to affect your rigging, but it is going to push a bunch of air to allow you to have that brightness in a monitor that's this size. And so then on this side, you can see here that it has the grate here, which I would imagine that the air is going to be pulled in from the fan and pushed out through these exhaust vents here. And then there is your standard NPF battery plate, the NPF style batteries, which look something like this. This is the big brick one. This is the 976. They come in a whole host of sizes. I'll link those down below. But these batteries are pretty much universal for accessories, so that's pretty cool. Now, if you are running universal power, the other thing that you could do is power it via this DC port or get a dummy battery, which looks like this. This is an NPF style battery here, which you could then just mount here and then have this to D-tap, which is going to be a much more familiar port type on a camera that's rocking, you know, an Anton Bauer battery or something like that. That would be V-mount or goal mount. That's another option there. It comes with an HDMI to HDMI mini cable. And then it of course comes with this mounting arm like so. And there you go. So then this is a cold shoe mount here that you can mount onto a camera. And it just so happens that I have a camera. So we're going to mount this on, power it up, and kind of go through what this has to offer. All right, so now that I've got this hooked up, you can see here that it is a large monitor, especially compared to a camera that's as small as the Komodo. But the nice thing is that this, of course, is both HDMI and SDI. So if I wanted to put this on my GH5S, I have HDMI for that. If I wanted to put it on the Komodo, I could use SDI for that. So this type of a monitor that has both port styles gives you a lot of versatility depending on the camera that you're using. So if you are somebody who currently has an HDMI camera but might be upgrading to an SDI capable camera in the future, it might make more sense to invest in a monitor that's going to future-proof your kit a little bit here. But I have SDI for this guy, so I'm going to take off the little cap cover, which I really like the BNC cap covers that they have. All right, I know it kind of looks weird like this because we would never use a monitor like this, but it works for the overhead so we can kind of see what we're doing here. So press and hold the power button to turn this on. You'll see that that light is then going to turn green. And we have power here. So now you can see that we can see what's going on. And then of course, because this is a red, we have our menu options kind of around the border. Like with all touch screens on the FEELWORLD series, the monitor is split in half, kind of invisibly, where the left half of the monitor is going to be for your brightness and the right half of the monitor is going to be your volume. So all you do is you press anywhere on this and then you either swipe up or swipe down and you can kind of adjust the brightness on the left side or the same on the right here, but with the volume of the monitor itself. That would be for the headphones, so you'd be able to hear what's going on in the headphones. You can see here that even with the aperture 300Ds that I've got here on either side, 50% is plenty bright for the studio, but you can increase this to full brightness, and full brightness of course gives you that 2600 nit count, which is going to be what makes it daylight viewable. Again, the UI of this works the same on all FEELWORLD monitors. If you swipe up from the bottom, it's going to pull up your quick menu, 9 grid, safety marker, center mark, mark mat, false color, LUT switching. You could do all of that there. If you want to access the full menu, that is a double tap. A double tap anywhere on the screen is then going to pull up the sidebar, which gives you all of the functions that this monitor has. Now, if you don't want to use the touch screen, you can use this menu rocker up here at the top. By pressing in, it will pull up the bottom menu here. And then of course, simple pressing, you can turn things on and off as needed. If you press and hold, it will then pull up this side menu, which you can then work your way through here again by a series of presses and rocks. The touchscreen works really well on this monitor and with all the FEELWORLD monitors. So I generally use the touchscreen just because it's simpler for me to tap and drag my way through as opposed to having to use the rocker, but that is an option available to you. So once we get into the menu of this here, so I will double tap here, we'll pull this up. On this side here, we have our focus assist, zebra, monochrome, false color. All of those are very standard settings within our FEELWORLD system. The next one here pulls up our 9 grid, that's our rule of thirds. Safety markers, center marker, marker mat, and then the marker color. The marker mat is again for your aspect ratios, so depending on the aspect ratio of your deliverables, you can then go through and, for instance, like this, if I know that I'm gonna be cropping this down to be kind of that cinescope 235, 240 range, I can do that here, just so then that way, even though I'm recording at 16:9, I get a good sense for what my actual final framing would be. We'll come in here and we will turn that off. Okay, like that. And then of course you could change the color of those markers as you see fit. The next one down here, we then have all of our video to monitor settings. So this is where I would select whether I want it to be anamorphic, what aspect ratio I want it to be, whether I have it underscanned, overscanned, no scanning. If I want to mirror the monitor, if I'm using it as a reference monitor, how many times I want it to be able to zoom, if I want to freeze on a frame, pixel to pixel ratioing off or on, all of that stuff, if you just kind of leave it on auto, is going to be fine for most things unless you have very specific use cases. Then we'll go down to the next one here, which is going to be kind of where all of our waveforms exist. This is the waves, the vector scopes, your parades, the RGB histogram, your regular histogram, audio metering, all of that kind of stuff. This is all ways that we would check our exposure. So again, if I was to turn on our vector scopes and our parade and a histogram and my audio meters, you can see here very quickly, this has then gone from just being a preview monitor into being something that really gives me a good sense for the different levels of my both video exposure and then my audio meters, so I can know that I'm not clipping in either one. So on and off. Again, the touchscreen is super, super responsive. So then we'll come down here. This is where we would go into our LUTs. So at the top here, I would be able to turn on or off the LUTs at the top. The next one is a LUT out option. Because this is a loop through monitor, it gives you the option of whether you want to send the LUT that's in this preview out through your signal to whatever else you're going to, or if you want to ignore the LUT as it pushes that signal out. So that's a really, really handy feature there. We also then can select the type of LUT that we're using. So for instance, like right now, we have kind of all of the standard logs, which would be log C, which is our Canon log, S log 2 and 3, which is the Sony logs, and then Vlog, which is for Panasonic. With Red, because we're shooting in RAW, you could load in your own custom Rec 709 LUT. And the next one is the LUT import feature. So if I turn this on, it's then going to be trying to read the SD card that's in here. To load the LUT is really simple. You just format an SD card and then directly into the root folder, which is just the main folder. Don't create subfolders or anything. Drop your LUTs, load the SD card here into the bottom, and then in here you would go directly to this and hit LUT import, and then it'll go initializing, and it would then load the LUTs in for you if we had LUTs. I don't have anything in here right now, so we don't need that. The next is HDR. This is if you have a camera that is capable of recording in HDR, you would be able to set which version or type of HDR you want to record. And then the bottom is all just your general monitor settings, the color temperature of your monitor, backlight, brightness, all of that stuff, sharpness, hue, saturation, that kind of thing. I have found that these monitors are fairly well calibrated in terms of color rendering, so I generally don't feel the need to adjust much within that. But if you have a custom calibrator and you want to go through and really dial it in, you have those options available to you. At the bottom here, we have our settings. This is where we have kind of the just general monitor functions. So at the top here, we can say what we want the monitor to do, and you can adjust things. So we can have the wheel itself adjust the volume for headphones, we can adjust the brightness for our backlight, or we can adjust the zoom. So if I want to preview this, I can then just use this and I can zoom in on my monitor like this. So if I wanted to check focus or something, I could do that as well. I don't really use the rocker for anything, because if I want to zoom in, it's much easier to just pinch and drag like that than it is to use the wheel for. So if you wanted to do that for backlight or for volume, it'd be fine. I just generally don't use it much myself. So then you have your language, your OSD settings, your volume, whether you want it to be muted or not, the fan, which is automatically set to auto, which is gonna then kick the fan on, turn it off, raise it, lower it, depending on the temperature of the unit. But then, of course, we can then have it off, low, middle, or high. Always leave it on auto. You don't wanna overheat your monitor. And you know, you don't, unless you're in like super, super, super sound sensitive environments, you're not gonna really even notice it. You can factory reset the monitor. And then this, which is the important one, is your input. You can select the input between HDMI and SDI, but if you plug it in and it's not reading it, you just simply come over into your settings, go to input, and then change it between SDI or HDMI. Like that. And then firmware is at the bottom, firmware update. Again, you would go to FEELWORLD's website, download the latest firmware, put that into the root folder of your SD card, load the SD card in here, and then tell it to update. It will then read it off the card, go through the update process, and you would be just fine. And those are all of the basic settings. This monitor, being a FEELWORLD monitor, is exactly what I would want it to be. They make fantastic monitors, for the price point that they have. They have all of the professional settings that I expect in an on-camera monitor like that. I'm a big fan. So if you are in the market for a new monitor and need something that is both affordable but has all of the capabilities that you would be looking for, this is a monitor that checks all of those boxes. I hope you found this helpful, and if you did, do me a favor and give this video a like. If you want to see more stuff like this, hit subscribe and that little bell. And as always, I will see you in the next episode.